So, good day and welcome to today's lesson on the Gauss-Jacobi. So, today we are going to go through the matrix approach. Okay, and after going through that, we will use that to solve this question here. You will discuss this question here. Alright, so before you can understand the matrix approach of using the Gauss-Jacobi to solve systems of linear equation iteratively, there are certain keywords or certain important terms that you have to be familiar with. So let's go through those keywords. So you have to know what you mean by a matrix being strictly diagonally dominant, right? So strictly diagonally dominant matrix. So let us consider a 3x3 matrix as we have here. A, so A11, A12, A13. These are 3x3 matrices. So we see this matrix A here is strictly diagonally dominant if the diagonal here, so you see the diagonal elements are A11, A22, A33. So in the first row, if this condition is met, I hope you see, so the absolute value of A11 is greater than that of A12 plus that of A13. So in the second row, that of A22 is greater than the rest, and in the third row, that of A33 is greater than the rest. So if these three conditions are met, then we see our matrix A is a strictly diagonally dominant matrix. So that's what you mean by a matrix being strictly diagonally dominant, right? So please take that. So let's go to what a strictly lower triangular matrix is. So, and what a strictly upper triangular matrix is, and what a diagonal matrix is. So those are the next things we are going to talk about. So you realize that this was our A matrix here. So you realize that the diagonal elements are A11, A22, A33. So these form the diagonal matrix. So A11, A22, A33, and the rest of the elements are zero. So whenever you have a matrix, this is how we form our diagonal matrix from it. Alright, then we know that in forming our lower triangular matrix, it will be given by A11 0 0, then you have A21 A22 0, then we're gonna have A31, A32, and A33. So this happens to be our lower triangular matrix. But in this case, we are talking about a strictly lower triangular matrix. So for a strictly lower triangular matrix, our diagonal elements are all zero. So that means that in this case, we are going to have zero here. So that's how we get our strictly lower triangular matrix. Then let's go to our upper triangular matrix. So upper triangular matrix U, we know will be given by A11, A21, A31. Then we have 0 here, A22, A23. So we have 0, 0, and A33. So with an upper triangular matrix, this is what we have. But for the strictly upper triangular matrix, our diagonal elements are also zero. So that means we are going to have simply something like this. And there is a property. So the property is that when you add D plus L plus U, it always gives you your E. So you can do that and you realize that that's correct. Okay, so you have to check these properties. They are very, very important in you understanding what we are about doing. So let's start with the main work for today. So the Gauss-Jacobi, so the matrix approach. So we have this question here, and the first thing we want to do is I want to rearrange this question for it to be strictly diagonally dominant, right? So you realize that with this particular question here, when you write it in the augmented matrix form, that's in this form, you're going to have this. So you realize that in this form, this matrix here is not diagonally dominant or strictly diagonally dominant. So to make it strictly diagonally dominant, that means that the absolute value of the elements here should be greater than the rest when you add them. The same way the one here should be so be greater than the rest, the one here and the one here. So we have to make sure we swap rules and do some manipulations to get what you want to get. So you realize that we want whatever we have here, the absolute value of it to be greater than that of this, this, and this. So what we do is that we swap rule 1 and rule 2. So we swap rule 1 and rule 2. So you realize that after swapping rule 1 and rule 2, we are going to end up with this, right? So this becomes our new rule 1. This becomes our new rule 2. And we maintain this. So you realize that with this particular rule 1 here, the absolute value of 10 here is greater than that of negative 2 plus that of negative 1 plus that of negative 1. So you realize that here we have 10 being greater than 4. So that means that we are okay with the first rule. So in the second, we realize that we have to make sure what we have here is larger than the rest in absolute sense. So what we do is that we swap rule 2 and rule 4. So that our 10 will rather come here. So after swapping rule 2 and rule 4, realize that we have our 10 here. And when you do the same thing, you realize that the absolute value of this is larger than the absolute value of the sum of the rest. So the next thing is to make sure we have our 10 here again. So we swap rule 3 and rule 4. And after doing that swap, we get this particular augmented matrix here. So you realize that this particular augmented matrix here is diagonally dominant because here, this, the absolute value is larger than the rest, here, this, and here to that, right? So that means that you've been able to make the above matrix that we had strictly diagonally dominant. So the coefficient matrix is this, that's the whole of this, and our constant vector is this b here. Alright, so the next thing we want to do is that we like to form a diagonal matrix from our A. So in forming a diagonal matrix from our A, that means it is going to be the diagonal entries. So that's what we have here, 10, 10, 10, negative 10, and the rest are all 0. Then to form our strictly lower triangular matrix is going to be the normal lower triangular matrix we have, except that our diagonal entries are all 0. So the same way we also form our strictly upper triangular matrix, it's just a normal way of forming an upper triangular matrix, except that our diagonal elements are all 0. So we've been able to find our D, L, and U. So have you realized that those keywords or terminologies we talked about before starting our work has been really important? So you realize that our A here is equal to D plus L plus U. So when you add this to this and to that, you realize that it is going to give us this, our A here. Alright. So these are the first things that you have to know. Right. So the next thing that we are coming to derive the formula for doing the iteration. So if you know that whenever we have any system of equation, it is given as Ax equals B, where A is the coefficient matrix, B is our constant vector, and X is the unknown, what you are finding for. But you know now our A is the same as D plus L plus U. So that means that we are going to have, in place of A here, we are going to have D plus L plus U times X equals B. I hope you get it. And this is the same as BX plus LX plus UX equals B. So we can get DX and decide to, put this here in this form equals b. So we're trying to make the d times x the subject, and it will give us b minus l plus u times x. So we are finding for x here, so we divide through by d, but since this is matrix, when divided through it becomes inverse. So that means s will be equal to d inverse times b minus d inverse times l plus u all times x. I hope you get that. All right, so when we get this, then we let h, which stands for the Jacobi matrix, to be equal to negative d inverse l plus u x. Right, then we let our d, a certain d, be equal to d inverse times b. So here now our x here can be written in the form x equals d here plus h. So you can take dg plus hg, and this is the same as x equals hg plus dg, since addition is commutative. Alright, so it doesn't matter the positioning. So this is what we want to prove here. So sorry, we have x here and we have an x here. So this is what we have tried to prove here. That's the explanation to what we have done. So you realize that whatever I explain here is what I've written here. Okay. Right, so now how we do the iteration is that the iterative process is that we have sk plus 1 equals hj sk plus dj. So for instance, you know, always you have been given an initial condition. So let's say initial condition at x0 is 0, 0, 0. So when you are doing your first iteration, it's going to be x1 be equal to hj times our x naught initial condition plus our dj, and we use this to get the first iteration, which is quite simple. So note this formula very well. Right, so this our h here is equal to this we have here. So note that if we had made our h to be equal to d inverse l plus u, that means that our s k plus 1 would have been equal to negative hj plus dj. So we have sk here, and that would have given us the same response. Thus, if we admit our h to be d inverse times l plus u, then we'd have brought the negative here. But since here we brought the negative here, then there is no need to bring the negative here. I hope you get that. So try to reason around that and you will get it. Alright, that's excellent. So that means with that A matrix, we have to find our H and our D. So we recall that our H is giving us minus D inverse times L plus U. So this is our D. So this is our minus, this is our D, the inverse of it. Then there's L plus U, where L is our strictly lower triangular matrix and our U is our strictly upper triangular matrix. So when we add these two matrices, we are going to have this. And when we find the inverse of our diagonal matrix, we are going to get something. So just a quick note here. Note that the inverse of a diagonal matrix is obtained by replacing each element in the diagonal with its reciprocal. So for instance, when you have C to be 2, 0, 0, 4, the inverse will just be 1 over 2, 0, 0, 1 over 4. So that means to get the inverse here, you're going to replace here with 1 over 10, 1 over 10, 1 over 10, negative 1 over 10. So I hope you understand. So that means our D inverse will be this, as we can see here. So our H will be equal to negative D inverse times L plus U, which is going to give us negative whatever we have here. So this is going to be our H. I hope you get it. All right, then we know that our D is equal to the diagonal matrix, its inverse times B, and that is going to give us this times this. I hope you know from our question B is giving us this, and we know the inverse of our diagonal matrix is giving us this. So when you do this matrix vector multiplication, you're going to get your D to be this. I hope you get it. All right, so now we come to the iterative process. But recall that the iterative matrix is given by this particular relation as we have here. And in the question, we're given an initial condition that S naught to be 0, 0, 0, 0. So that means that in doing our first iteration, recall that S k plus 1 equals H j S k plus D. So in the initial condition, our k is 0, right? So that means that to find S1, it will be H j X naught plus D. To find X2, or the second iteration, to be HG X1 plus D. So you use a value here for X to find that, and it continues. So in doing the first iteration, we are going to get S of 1, which is the first iteration, will be our H, so which is negative whatever we have here, times our initial condition given to us, which is 0, 0 plus our D matrix here. So realize that since we are multiplying this matrix by the 0 vector, this component goes to 0. So that means that our S1 will be giving us this, right? So that's going to be the value for our X's after the first iteration. So if you are to continue from the second iteration, then you are going to have this. So X2 be equal to HJ S of 1 plus DJ. Then X of 3 will be equal to HJ S of 2 plus DJ. So up till you get SN is equal to HJ S of N minus 1 plus DJ. So that's it with the matrix approach in terms of the Gauss-Jacobi. Okay, so thank you very much for watching this video. Please don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel and please like the video if it helps you. So in the next video, we are going to go through the same thing but for the Gauss-Seidel. Thank you.